or beat groups even?
The showband audience was not our audience, definitely not. So we had a very niche audience in Ireland. We did a few things in some of the beat clubs with some of the hipper type beat groups who were out there at the time, who could actually see that what we were doing had merit and had interest. The pop bands wouldn't see that. And a lot of the so-called bands at the time, so-called beat bands, really were just pop bands. But there were one or two, and they, like the Young Full Limit, and I was very intrigued by what we were up to.
And then there were the sort of, you know, Planxty's, Johnny Moynihan, and that group, which was more pure folk, if you like. And then there were ourselves, who sort of fell between two stools in a way, because we were, I suppose, psychedelic folk, or psychedelic lounge music, we used to say. And we basically only played our own songs, because we couldn't play anyone else's.
And seemed to be otherwise employed, and to your thinking, very intent and busy. Still, that toy runs in their mind, that fear, that suspicion, that abuse, that jealousy, that agony, that vexation, that fiction, that pleasant waking dream. Catman the Minotaur, you'd better lick your lips. The film's almost over, they're only showing clips. The prelate's on the pig's back, and he's running down the hill. The swans turn to sailing ships, the honey's on the windowsill.
It was a very small scene, and anybody who was involved in alternative music or rock music, good rock music, or the arts, perhaps to some extent, certainly the arts, not so much with the writers, though we did hang out with a few of the writers, we all knew each other. And we're good friends, and we'd meet at parties and pubs, and there was a lot of bouncing ideas off each other. And as I recall it, there wasn't much artistic jealousy at the time, which was excellent. Everybody really wanted to sort of do something with our youth and with our talent, and in a slightly Irish way. And that almost contradicts what I just said, because I was influenced a lot by American stuff. But at the same time, I could see that that could relate and kind of invert and come back out of Ireland in some way. I don't know how this guy heard of us. He made a very rough demo recording on a single reel-to-reel Nagra. With the sound man from Ardmore at the time, a guy called Liam Sorum, who's a very good sound engineer. So he made us sound halfway decent.
It was through the Incredible String Band, really, that they said to Joe Boyd, who was a major figure, you know, we have these friends, you know, who've got a band, why don't you listen to them? You might be interested. And Joe graciously agreed. He came over from England, and we were doing a gig in Carlow. And he came along to the gig, and we were on with Skid Row were on that gig as well. And I think he was more impressed by Skid Row than by us, really, you know.
So he said, look, come over and record. And so we recorded Kip of the Serenes, and then he leased taped that to Ireland. And then Joe produced us from then on in.
Strings in the earth and air make music sweet. Strings by the river, where the willows meet. There's music along the river, for love wanders there. Pale flowers on his mantle.
So we went over to London, we recorded Kip of the Serenes in Sound Techniques in Chelsea. I think John Wood was the engineer, with Joe Boyd as producer. And that was a really good team, John Wood and Joe Boyd. And it was all recorded very quickly, I think it was 2 or 3 days, as far as I remember, and not a lot of overdubs. It would be very much as if we were doing a gig.
I think we were the first band ever in Ireland to actually get an outside deal. I think we got our deal with Island before Thin Lizzy got any sort of deal, as far as I recall. It was very rare for an Irish band to have an English recording company. But the deal wasn't like the deals you get now. I don't recall any advances. If there was an advance, that went to Joe to pay for recording. And then the royalties were divvied up to cover that.
Joe Boyd tried to encourage us to try and branch out a bit, and he suggested using things like synthesizers, which were only just coming in at that time, you know. But we weren't really ready for that. We were only just discovering how to play what we had, you know.
Well, the actual sounds were two guitars and a whistle, basically, and a harmonium. And a few strange things. I mean, that we might buy something in the market that day—a kazoo or a one-string fiddle or a melodica or something—and we'd actually bring it on stage and play with it that night. We were bold and brave.
We had guitars and ocarina and saz. I had got a saz in Turkey in the bazaar in Turkey, which is it's kind of Greek mandolin, you know. And it's a precursor of bouzouki. And I didn't know how to play it, but I kind of worked out a primitive way of doing a few things on it, you know.
It was sort of throw everything into a bag, really. I mean, for instance, I know that there's a beginning of one of my songs, My New Shoes Are Pinching. That's called, Mary Malone of Moscow. And I think Tim had just got a banjo, and I think he only knew four chords on the banjo, so we decided to use those four. It was very much like use what you have, even though you mightn't have an awful lot.
Out of the window, golden hair, I heard you singing a merry air. I've left my book, I have left my room, for I heard you singing through the gloom.
Yeah, we started the tour of the English University, sir, which was quite good because, I mean, it wasn't huge amount of money per gig, but it was way more than we could get in Dublin or anywhere in Ireland. And we also, you were sort of guaranteed that you were paid. Where in Ireland in the 60s, the promoters who were out there were, you know, very, very dodgy. You know, there were all kinds of excuses why they wouldn't pay you. You'd still done the work.
Fairport Convention, we did lots of gigs with Sandy Denny, who's a wonderful singer. And but I wish Tim Booth, had this poster, and I think he lost it. Because we did a gig in High Wycombe once, and top of the bill were Dr. Strangely Strange, and second on the bill was Elton John. So I'd love to have that poster. It'd be great fun.
Elton John came out in these hot pants with a Mr. Freedom t-shirt, and, you know, spangly boots, you know, and, you know, star written all over it, you know, and we were kind of shuffling around with the harmonium and kind of plugging things in, you know, in our, you know, usual kind of funky way, you know, and obviously we weren't in the same league, you know.
Well, we used to play in a club called Les Cousins, or Les Cousins, no, Les Cousins it was called, and it was in Greek Street in London, and String Band used to play there, and it was our sort of headquarters musical gig in England. We'd always come, whenever we did a tour in England, there'd always be one or two gigs in Cousins in Greek Street. It was in a basement. And so I remember John Martin playing there, I think probably before he even became sort of professional, really. And I'm pretty sure Nick Drake played there that night. That night I was talking to you about. And I remember going up to after the gig,